For our next session, please welcome the CEO of HCA Healthcare, Sam Hazen. In a conversation with the CEO and Managing Director of General Catalyst, Hemant Taneja. I'm gonna fight them all. I said the nation army couldn't hold me back. They're gonna rip it off.
Taking their time. Good evening. So at General Catalyst, we've been focused on this health assurance transformation, which is a systemic move to something that we all want, which is proactive care that's affordable and accessible. And one of the core tenets for us is no single company can do that alone. And it really is about radical collaboration between technology and healthcare. So about a year ago, Sam and I announced a partnership between HCA and General Catalyst, which was all about that collaboration between technology and healthcare and bringing innovation into the sector. And it actually started 4 years before that, our conversation, when Sam was in the Valley meeting a bunch of technology companies to see what's going on, and that was actually before the pandemic. So maybe what we can do, Sam, is start with just, if you think about the last 3 or 4 years, how have your innovation priorities evolved overall?
I'm trying to forget the last 3 years, Hemant, but So, you know, it's interesting for us, the pandemic has yielded a lot of learnings, and we're trying to take those learnings forward as an organization and really benefit from the pandemic as a team. And right now, obviously, we're dealing with a supply chain shock in the healthcare system because of the labor shortages that have occurred. Healthcare, at least in the space we're in, is labor intensive. And we're experiencing a unique supply chain shock. And we have this gross imbalance across the country today with demand for healthcare and then supply for healthcare. And it's especially acute in certain areas of healthcare, behavioral health in particular, and so forth. So at this particular juncture, we're focused on our workforce and how do we develop workforce to really meet the demand and meet the needs of our organization. Obviously, technology can play a part in that. It's not going to fix today's problems today, but over time, I think it can really advance what we need to do with workforce. And really, fundamentally, what we're trying to do with workforce is extend the reach of the resources that we have, extend the reach of our physicians and how they interact with their patients, extend the reach of our nurses and how they care for our patients, and really extend the ability of our management teams organizationally to manage our business, you know, more efficiently with better outcomes and so forth, how we use capital, all those kind of things. So we've come out of the pandemic with a very focused effort around digitizing HCA Healthcare in ways that other industries have done. We're woefully behind, and we perform at a high level as an organization, but we're woefully behind on the use of technology and really advancing the care process. So workforce development is the first thing we're focused on. So we have huge training programs. We're trying to use technology where we can, but we're really in a situation where the COVID gift keeps on giving with respect to workforce. And obviously, just like every other industry, inflation is a real issue in healthcare with the labor costs for sure, but even in other categories of our organization, and we're having to deal with that. But technology, again, can play a part, I think, in helping us navigate through financial pressures that are related to inflation or whatever the case may be. So those are the big learnings. I think as an organization, Hemant, we came through the pandemic and learned that priorities really matter. We took a very conservative philosophy as an organization heading into the pandemic. We've literally taken care of 400,000 inpatients who've had COVID. We've gone through four different surges. So it forced us to really manage our business in ways that were responsive to our communities, responsive to our patients, and responsive to our people. And so carrying forward those priorities and really connecting people to that is important. And what's exciting to me is our team, our physicians, our nurses, our management teams see the opportunity with technology as a solution to today's problems as well as really a hope for tomorrow's. And so that's where we've got our focus today, and we're carrying forward those lessons that we did learn.
One of the things I admire, I mean, this is a time where all systems are under a lot of pressure. in the healthcare industry, and not only have you guys managed to maintain the profitability, but also be disciplined about the fact that the true north around innovation is has to be protected and invested in. And I think that's that sort of focus on the long-term thinking is really admirable, because this just won't happen overnight. And you know, the observation that you and I spoke about 4 years ago was healthcare was really left alone by the technology industry in a lot of ways. There was a lot of technology debt, and so there was a pressure to solve a lot of these problems yourself, and how do you move towards digitization. But a few years ago, you started thinking about, well, partnerships really need to drive this work. Just talk about that philosophy and how the partnerships are going to play a role in that digitization for you.
Well, I think the healthcare industry at the highest level is incredibly fragmented, and that fragmentation hurts sort of the country's outcome with respect to patient outcomes, patient experience, efficiency, value, whatever you want to throw out there. Fragmentation is the fundamental issue in my estimation. And so when we went into COVID, one of the things we went into COVID with was guiding principles. One of the guiding principles was that we needed to partner with whomever to get through the pandemic, because we had not experienced something at that level. And that opened our eyes to how unique our platform is. And again, we're big in the industry, but we're really small by comparison to other industries where you have scaled players. We're 6% of the nation's hospital services as an organization. Now, we're big in markets that we serve, but we've got a unique platform that we think we haven't fully leveraged, because we don't have all the internal capabilities that we need to really advance our agenda with technology, advance our agenda with care transformation and innovative solutions to how we deliver care. And so partnerships are very important to our long-term agenda. And attaching capable providers or entities or organizations like General Catalyst and your all's ability to be quick with solutions potentially to our chassis is something that's really appealing to me and really appealing to our enterprise, because we think we can accelerate our agenda. We're a laboratory. We have 185 hospitals. We have, on any given day, 35,000 patients in a bed, and there's a lot of learnings that can happen. And healthcare is a great human learning industry, but it hasn't really instituted, in my estimation, scaled solutions for machine learning to buttress the human learning. And so the formula maybe in healthcare could be even greater with machine learning and technology and partnerships with organizations. So partnerships for us is a very important ingredient to accelerating our agenda. And it is a long run agenda. I talk to our teams all the time, Hemant, about the fact that it's a journey. And yeah, we're in a resiliency mode right now because inflation is forcing that. But we've got three things that we have not compromised as we're pushing. We're not compromising our patients for sure, but we're not compromising our technology agenda. We're not compromising our innovation and care transformation agenda. And we're not compromising our workforce development agenda. We're a massive educator with respect to people also. Largest physician educator in the country with our residency programs. We will soon be probably the second largest nursing educator with our College of Nursing. And then we have a huge leadership effort to train people. So those three things are very important to our success long term, but we have to have people who can align with us, Hemant, and help us through that. I will tell you, partnerships are not easy, and you have to have a long run view on partnerships, like getting married. Wasn't easy in the first year, but it starts to get a little
just
easier.
A year.
Well, if you ask my wife, it's, you know, way over
still
30
day
years.
By day.
She's still waiting for the partnership to generate something. I think from that standpoint, sometimes people get too impatient with partnerships and don't realize that it takes a while to get a rhythm. It takes a while to really have some early successes and build on those. And we have a ton of partnerships. And we just recently announced a few other partnerships that are really, we learned from you all early on coming out of the gate that this can be something to help our company.
So talk a bit about the care transformation agenda. You've set up an office with Mike Schlosser and team, and you've also created an interesting program management capability to work with folks like us. Just talk through the priorities there over the next few years.
Yeah, so let me back up for a minute on that one, because what's happened in healthcare? Healthcare is a bespoke industry. We have almost 300,000 employees. We have 50,000 physicians. And there's a lot of individually tailored solutions. But we have patterns. We have patterns in our company. We take care of obstetrics patients. We take care of orthopedic patients. We take care of cardiac patients. Well, we did that last week also. We did that last year also. And we'll do that next year. And so there's an enormous amount of patterns. And so we haven't really had a capability in our company to learn from those patterns, nor have we had a capability in our company to really challenge the processes that go into the care delivery. And so we set up a care transformation and innovation organization. It's married carefully with our technology agenda, and I do believe it's the holy grail for us when it comes to better decision making on the front end by our clinical strategists, our physicians. They are literally strategists for you, me, whoever. And so if we can help them make better strategic decisions for their patient population, then we can get a better outcome. The other thing we think it can do is really support and create a safer environment where the machine, if you will, is running behind the scenes, understanding these patterns, and communicating with our nurses in ways that are much better than what we do today. And then the third thing for us is patient transparency. We think there's an opportunity to have consistent processes, eliminate the variation that exists across our company and across the industry as a whole, and have a more transparent and easier to navigate, if you will, system of care. And so our care transformation and innovation agenda is very important to our purpose as an organization. It's very important to our patient outcomes. We think it's going to deliver tremendous efficiencies for us, help us manage our assets even better. So I'm really excited about that agenda, especially coupled with our technology agenda. But partnering with people who can devise solutions to what they're finding, and they're finding a lot of opportunities even in our company, and we're pretty high performing across most dimensions, but our processes are way too inconsistent. And I think that variation is the frustration that all of our patients have. Our physicians have it, we have it, communities have it, and so that's part of what we're trying to do to eliminate that variation.
So Sam, I want to talk a little bit about health equity. Just given your footprint, you obviously get to serve all demographics, and that's an important topic for you. How are you thinking about that in the next phase?
Well, it's a really complex agenda, and I don't think HCA Healthcare by itself can solve the problem. Partnerships are how we think we can solve the problem. So we're taking a dual approach. One approach is if we see variation and inequities in our own delivery, let's fix those. So we have visibility into those. And we are using metrics and data to help us understand, do we have different outcomes for African-American women in our obstetrics units versus white women? And then if so, how do we fix those inside the walls of our hospitals? But if there are outcomes that are outside the walls of our hospitals with respect to social issues, whatever, how do we partner with communities? How do we partner with the payers? How do we partner with not-for-profit systems and really extend the reach of what we see in our facilities to the community in ways to help with some of these issues? And so that's how we're approaching it. We've announced a big partnership with the March of Dimes. We've announced a partnership with J&J. We've got a partnership with American Heart Association we just announced that are all intended to leverage our resources, leverage their resources, leverage our information, and put that to work to help our communities in a way that I think is really impactful. So it's a long pull. It's not easy, and what we're trying to do is use our learnings married up with our resources, other capabilities, and really deliver a community outcome that's hopefully positive.
Yeah. So one of the areas that we think a lot about is this transition to value-based care. And that's obviously a place where we've had interesting conversations, and you've got a fair amount of skepticism that that will happen anytime at scale in the short term. Talk a bit about just how you think about that transition, and you know, does it make sense, and how long will it take?
I didn't think you would ask me that question. I think value-based care means so many different things to different people that it's really hard to define. Yeah. I think at the highest point in the healthcare system, people are not satisfied with the value they ultimately get, whether it's the government as a payer, an employer as a payer, or a patient individually. So value inside of those different elements of the you know, the business, they vary. And there've been a lot of experimentation, a lot of research, a lot of different programs. And really up to this point, nothing has really added that much value, I don't think. For us, I mean, we're trying to make sure that we interact with the patient, interact with the physician, and interact with the payer in a way that's satisfactory to their objectives, satisfactory to ours. Our job at our core is to take care of people in need. And so we want to make sure we have resources to allocate to investments, to technology, to training, to facilities, to convenience, all of those things that allow us to have a system approach to healthcare and really meet a diverse set of needs and really diverse values. Our physicians, some of them want risk-based relationships, some don't. Some of our employers like this particular payment methodology, some don't. So we have to adapt to that variation in issue in the different markets. So I don't think value-based care in a really narrow term is doable. It has to be flexible and really meet a different set of needs.
Yeah, I mean, it's you know, we're investing in a series of companies around this, and it's a fairly complex problem, as you said. I think we're going to hopefully create some evidence in small parts and then over time scale. So this is a very long game from our standpoint. So there's a lot of innovators in the room, and everybody wants to work with HCA, given the scale and the complexity and the market opportunity that you all represent. And that includes big tech, that includes, you know, small innovators. What advice do you have on what's the best way to engage with you all? Obviously, you know, we've learned a lot over the last year in terms of that cadence, and this is a large organization, so You know,
I've shared with you and I've shared with other CEOs of big tech companies that I think to really understand the healthcare system, you have to get into the healthcare system in a way that's a little bit different than maybe how tech has attached itself or disrupted other industries. They've been able to do it from afar, so to speak. I don't think, at least in the component of the industry that we're in, that you can do it from afar. You have to embed yourself in the interactions that take place between people and process, and then start to think about how technology can really impact that. And so that's probably frustrated some of these innovators and tech companies in the past, even with us. I mean, we're big and we can be clumsy at times. We try to make a big company small. So I think having innovative pilot projects or R&D type projects are something that we embrace. And so if we can prove something in Dallas-Fort Worth where we have a really large system, or prove something in Miami and then determine if it's scalable, then we start to think about it that way. But just coming in from the outside and attaching to our organization doesn't work. We have too many people that have too many different opinions. I'm talking physicians, nurses, and so forth. That really slows down the interaction. But if we can make the company a little bit smaller, regionalize it, if you will, prove out a concept, and really deliver value for people who are connected to that, then I think in that way, it makes it easier to navigate our organization. But we are receptive, and we see opportunities for people by bringing other organizations into ours and using our laboratory of facilities and services and so forth to interact with you know, organizations that can really advance our agenda.
Yeah, look, we're coming to the end of time. The only other thing I would add, just having interacted with you and your team, even though it's a large organization, it is fundamentally based on the premise of trust, and investing in that trust is great teams. And so, you know, we've been very excited about, you know, slow down to speed up, sort of having that kind of a mindset. And I think there's now a great set of ideas that are starting to emerge where hopefully we can bring these innovative companies together and create new models. So thanks for your partnership, and thanks for sharing your thoughts
with
the audience.
Thank you, Hemant. Yeah. Appreciate it.